Muy bien, señoras y señores, luego de la pausa para el café, retomamos el hilo y entramos ya en la última parte de la jornada de hoy, y tal cual lo anunciado, llega el momento del ejercicio.
As was announced, we will now engage in the group exercise, the workshop on innovation. This will be coordinated by Ms. Sinsmeyer. She faces the Access to Insurance Initiative on Digital Financial Inclusion, including research and the development of material for insurance supervisors on how to regulate innovation, including mobile insurance and other digital technologies. She's responsible for coordinating the Access to Insurance initiatives with the main donors. So we invite her on stage. She will be coordinating the group exercise. Thank you.
Thank you. So after we have heard about so many new digital technologies, about all the options of InsurTech, and after we heard like some of the approaches of the NIIC and how SUSEP are actually approaching this as a regulator, we wanted to take like a step back and follow up on the exercise that Andrea did this morning. So really to think about how you would regulate this in your market, in your jurisdiction. And if you're not a supervisor, please step in the shoes of the supervisor now, to really also think about the opportunities and challenges that the supervisor faces. We have handed out a number of worksheets, but before we enter into the group work, I wanted to talk a bit about the concepts again. We have heard the regulatory sandbox mentioned a number of times already now, so I'm not sure if everybody really knows like what this regulatory sandbox really looks like or how this is set up in the countries. And there are also a number of other approaches. So what we wanted to do is to discuss, and we grouped them into four different approaches. So one is the sandbox, which I will explain in a few seconds. The second is another test and learn approach, and then wait and see, or a full license. So I'm going through all of these approaches quickly now, and then we want to invite you to discuss them. So a regulatory sandbox is also only one of the test and learn approaches. So it's a very explicit approach where the supervisor invites a number of companies. So he starts a competition kind of and allows testing new innovations on a small scale, live and in controlled environment. So he sets safeguards. And the first sandbox was actually launched already in 2012 in the US by the US Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. And the term was coined then by the UK in 2015. So they called it a regulatory sandbox. And by now, like, more or less 20 countries have implemented a regulatory sandbox, but only, I think, like, I don't know, like, all of them, of course, but like, except Malaysia and Bahrain, I think nobody has actually created a sandbox that focused on financial inclusion. So a number of countries are now looking into creating sandboxes also to promote innovation that that promotes financial inclusion. So the typical sandbox approaches are coming from the UK, from the Netherlands, Singapore, Malaysia. A lot of Asian countries have that. And how is a sandbox set up? So, as I said, like, the supervisor invites a number of companies actually to tender, kind of, to apply for the sandbox. And before he does that, he needs to define the objectives of the sandbox. So is it that you want to promote financial inclusion? Is it that you want to promote competition or efficiency through, through innovation? And then he needs to define who can enter the sandbox. What are the kind of companies? Do you want to have startups? Do you want to have insurers? Do you allow also foreign companies or only like national companies? So really have to think through the criteria that you want to promote, because in the end it could turn out that you have like a number of applicants that you then have to work with closely afterwards. And then normally the sandboxes or the supervisors establish some safeguards. So they limit the number of customers that are allowed for the products. There's the strengthened disclosure rules, and sometimes it's also required to set up a compensation fund in case something happens. And there's a restricted time where it's implemented. And then on the side of the supervisor, what supervisors normally have is a dedicated team that really works with the companies that are selected by the sandbox. And what is always recommended is not to put it on top of their existing staff's workload, because it really requires that you work closely with the companies, and also to have like expertise on these new innovations or digital world. So, and the FCA, for example, in 2016, but the numbers are kind of the same, they invited, when they launched their regulatory sandbox in 2016, they received, just to give you some numbers, like 70 applications, and of these, they accepted 24 companies, and actually really like 18 firms were tested. And that means that the supervisor, the dedicated team of the supervisor, worked together with 18 companies to actually look into the business case, think about how to accommodate that in the market, what are the implications for the market, and those firms reported back regularly to the supervisors, and the FCA used waivers and non-enforcement letters to let them enter the market for a specific time, and the percentage of companies that then can enter the market is quite high. At least in the UK, it was around like almost 90%. So it's really that the FCA used that to, they thought about the criteria well in advance, and then they used that to promote innovators, and those actually are also active in the market. And then what might complement sandboxes in a number of countries are kind of like coding hubs, or like, I don't know, how do you call them, these innovation hubs where you bring together like ITs, where you also bring together companies to get a first like idea about that, but that is usually something that complements the sandbox approach. So that was a very long explanation. I'm quicker on the other ones. So test and learn is nothing that is new. It's kind of the same approach as the sandbox approach. You want to test and learn the innovations in your market. But the test and learn, what is referred to as test and learn, is more that a certain provider comes, like an innovator, comes with an idea to the supervisor and actually asks for an exemption. So this is ad hoc on a case-by-case basis. The supervisor then talks about like what restrictions or safeguards might need to be met. So one example of this is, for example, M-Pesa in Kenya, which I don't know if you're familiar with the concept of mobile money. So that M-Pesa started in 2007 with Safaricom, with a mobile network operator that wanted to offer that you can pay via airtime, and that you can establish a mobile wallet, kind of. So that was something very new, and it was a mobile network operator kind of entering the banking sphere. So that was something very new, and that started actually really just by that the regulator worked together with Safaricom to make that happen. And in the end, they requested that all the money that was held by the mobile network operator was put in a bank account. So they worked out a solution together. So that is another approach that you can go. And then you have the wait and see. Well, wait and see means that you actually monitor the trends in the market and try to better understand it before you take any intervention as a regulator. And it could mean that you don't do anything, but it actually should mean that you actively monitor and try to understand the developments that are taking place through active learning. And one example of this is always China. So China is kind of known that they are kind of liberal in allowing certain models to evolve before they actually find a regulation on that. And peer-to-peer lending is one example of this, where they allowed it for quite a long time to let it grow, until like the cases of fraud and also some other issues became more prevalent in the market. Yes, I think these are all the approaches now. And you find on your table, you find a sheet of paper. And we would just like to invite you. I'm just looking. Maybe we form three groups now because some people have left already. One group over here. I think one group over here will be fine, and one group over here, and maybe you join a bit together, to discuss these different approaches. So on top you have the different approaches, and then you have a number of criteria to just discuss a bit like the benefits and also the challenges with each of those approaches. And the criteria are given in the table. So it's formality, like how formal really is the approach. Does it require a change to legislation or board approval, whatever. What resources are needed to implement it? And not only financial resources, but also human resources. How flexible is it? Are you still as to modify it as needed? And transparency in terms of transparency to the market and to other companies. And then we have a second exercise. Where we would ask you to pick one of the innovations that you discussed before in the group work moderated by Andrea, and just have a look like how you would respond as a regulator in your market. Just pick one and just think it through, like what would be an appropriate approach from the view of the industry, from the view of the supervisor, and think about it, okay, what are the impacts on the markets and on the consumers? And for that, I think we have 40 minutes. So good luck with that.
Look at that. So you have 50 minutes left. Also think about like the second task, so at least pick one innovation and think about like how you would regulate it. Actually, don't stick too much with the numbers. Yeah, so 15 minutes left, and then also pick one, please, who will just feedback a bit about your discussions you had. Yes. So the last 2 minutes, please sum up and think about who's presenting, huh? Okay, I still see that you're discussing, but I think it's an endless, we'll not finish this now, the discussions. So I would just like to get a bit of feedback on what your discussions have been. Excuse me? Okay. So it would be nice just to hear from... Everybody's still discussing. So it would be nice to hear from every group, just on each of the regulatory approaches, just quickly about the discussion that you had, because there's no right or wrong in this, really not. And there are like so many different aspects that you have to take into account. I heard over there in some countries it's not possible to launch a sandbox. And just please share a bit on the discussions that you have on each of the approaches, and then for the second task, what innovation you picked and how you would go about it as a regulator. So let's start over here with that group that is still discussing. Yes. And I need some...
We assess the various tools for each dimension, and then as to formality in wait and see, one, test and learn, two, sandbox, three.
Refiere a flexibilidad.
As to flexibility, we thought it would be like a mirror of formality, so it's 4-3-1 for us. As to necessary resources, here we had different opinions within the group, because although we think that by having a lower level of formality, the reality is that they should have fewer resources, perhaps, but also the risks of that lower formality should lead perhaps to a higher provision So it was not clear for us as to how to classify the necessary resources. We thought of wait and see 2, test and learn 2, sandbox 3, licenses.
Y en lo que respecta a transparencia.
And as to transparency, of course, license, more transparent 4, sandbox 3, test and learn 2, wait and see 1. And then as to the second exercise, we were supposed to talk about the innovation we had picked in the previous activity. Most of us picked this claim prevention service that is intended to prevent the loss from happening as part of the service provided by the insurance and not the payment when the claim actually occurs. So the response from the regulator, well, we thought of the sandbox, the test and learn. That is something we would expect. Now, this is all very popular, at least in Argentina, in the private sector. We are using these agile technologies where we conduct some experiments and we learn from them to them, take them to a larger scale. And what impacts they might have on the market and on consumers? Well, on insurance companies themselves, we thought it required a huge investment given the responsibility related to managing all this information to provide the prevention service, data warehousing, and all that. And then on consumers, because all their data on their routines and biometric data are now public. Perhaps not public, but public with insurance companies. They're shared with insurance companies. So the privacy is lost. And as they mentioned here, if insurance companies have access to all biometrics of individuals, the cost of the insurance is now based on the risk of each individual. So this might take us to situations where if you have a high risk, you're supposed to be willing more for this service and the other way around. So the peer-to-peer sort of disappears. This is what we've been discussing, and other things as well. But we share this much.
Just not to repeat like that every group, but I think you said that like the most formal was the license. The most flexibility leaves like test and learn, wait and see approach. Most transparency is also with the license, you said. And the capacity, I don't know what you said about the capacity that is needed by the supervisor.
We related that to resources. So we combine that with the resources that are necessary. So we thought of capacity as what the market needs in order to support or tolerate the deviations from any of these innovations.
Yeah, it's true. There's also capacity and knowledge in the market needed, true. And I like the discussion that you had on the resources because it's not so straightforward. And also the impact on the longer term is not so, you really have to think it through. Okay, so the second group, could you share, like, not repeating all the numbers that you gave, but just the reflections that you had on the different approaches, if you had like other discussions than the former group, and also what innovation you picked and how you would wish to go about it as a supervisor?
Here we discuss formality, necessary resources,
los números, pero la mayor...
Most of the discussion focused on the second exercise, actually, the efforts required by the regulator. Because there's something very important here, that innovation is outside the regulatory framework. So if it's outside the regulatory framework, that is different from not being allowed by a specific law. Perhaps it's not very clear what this means. In Brazil, we do not have another law to cover this. So the regulatory framework can be below the law. So very often, it's more interesting for the regulator to wait and see. But always paying attention to what is happening. For instance, the digital platform is making some insurance sales that are not allowed by law. It's not allowed, but in Brazil, for instance, we had already contracts over the internet, but they didn't have a specific regulation. So now we decide, okay, we're going to observe and try to understand, and then we're going to move on to the test and learn. Then we're going to design a specific regulation for this kind of sales. Today, for instance, we have some electronic channels, and we can learn from that. So again, we made a change in the regulation. So I think that this is the main impact on the market. Perhaps it's not too huge of an impact. But so I first decided to wait and see, to observe, and then learn about it. It's important, but this may have an impact on consumers that may run into trouble with this kind of insurance.
I've heard this also before, that it's difficult to give like an exemption as a supervisor, or even not possible in some regulatory frameworks. In Brazil, you said you launched this, or you plan to launch a regulatory sandbox, right? So what would that include in Brazil?
Not necessarily.
We are not necessarily starting to do that, but we are understanding how this sandbox can be applied in the financial market first. And then the question is it applicable in the insurance market? That is the question that comes next. Because we have a limitation as to who can play the role of the insurer. For instance, an InsurTech that offers peer-to-peer insurance. The law in Brazil is clear. If this group that acts as a mutual group offers this insurance and a premium, then only insurance companies can do that. It's like, I mean, the law doesn't allow for that.
We are still trying to understand how to apply sandbox in the insurance market. And maybe sandbox could be some sort of channel for dialogue with all the insurance market, with the entire market, one of technology as well, to understand what is going on, maybe, and then take specific actions.
I think it's just important to also understand the markets. Before I quickly go back to that also, I just want to give the third group also the possibility to share a bit of the discussions that you had. Who wants?
We kind of shared the same with wait and see. Sandbox was assigned one, license two. Here we also included the international experience, because when we have some sort of innovation, or just like being here, trying to see what is already being done in order to then carry the experience forward and see how we would apply it in the cases we will have to deal with in our countries. In connection to part two, we had discussed about digital identity. Nonetheless, any product that we may have in hand, a new one, I mean, we agree on the fact that the countries in our region request for a plan to be submitted, meaning a proposal that will get submitted. It gets assessed to see whether it meets regulations in terms of consumer rights being protected. We call insurers in Paraguay. We make a proposal. And if we see that from a technical perspective, there are no major hurdles or problems. Of course, if there's problems, we ask for corrective action to be taken. Otherwise, we resort to the legal department to give their final say. And then we approve. And we stay careful to see what happens. The same is true in Panama and in Uruguay. Of course, we cannot forbid.
So what I've also picked out from the discussion is that it's in some markets really difficult to implement a sandbox. And it's not, I mean, we also, a lot of countries are now talking about implementing a sandbox, and we just want to make sure that it's also understood that it's kind of difficult to implement a sandbox in some markets, and that it's more about actually the attitude of the supervisor. So I have just put up this slide without going in any detail, but it just shows, like, on the right side you see communication support, and that actually just means that it's also just the attitude that you have as a supervisor and taking the possibilities and the framework that you have actually to try to learn about the market developments, try to bring together the industry, and you can create kind of like innovation hubs where you bring the industry together to try some things that work within the regulatory framework, try to provide like try to also get knowledgeable as a supervisor with trainings in-house, but also if you feel that that innovation is needed in your market and the market doesn't innovate itself, for example, to kind of follow a bit the approach that NAIC has, maybe kind of set InsurTech hubs to actually signal to your market that you want to promote this and give them a bit of the direction kind of that you want to go in the future. And that always has to, like, you must think about the resources that you need as a supervisor and the possibilities that you have as a supervisor. But what we found is that those countries also, and a lot of, I'm working more really in an African context, but a lot of supervisors there are also quite restricted by the regulation, but they still try to and want to make it happen, and they work together closely with the companies. Sometimes they just let them work in a gray zone until, because they see like some innovations are really, really positive for financial inclusion there. So it's really about the attitude. So that's what I just wanted to share as a last kind of like message on that exercise. And now I will just close here and yeah. Thank you.
Muchísimas gracias.
Thank you so much, Stephanie Sinsmeyer, for managing the session of this last working group. This is the last part of the 14th Consultative Forum on Microinsurance Regulation for Insurance Supervisory Authorities, Insurance Professionals, and Policy Developers. InsurTech Getting to Regulatory Challenge. The final remarks will be by the Regional Coordinator for Latin America Initiative to Access to Insurance by Ms. Regina Simoes. Thank you. On behalf of the Access to Insurance Initiative, I'd like to thank you all for your participation in this 14th Consultative Forum on Microinsurance Regulation under the motto of InsurTech. I'd like to thank you all, those that attended the session today, and those who were present on the streaming modality. We are thankful to ASAL for the opportunity to conduct this event together with their own training seminar, creating a unique situation, an opportunity for dialogue between supervisors, industry representatives, and other stakeholders. I'd like to thank the Board of Directors for their support and the support of the Secretariat in Chile for their logistical support. It's a sure thing that without this cooperation, the Consultative Forum of Latin America wouldn't be as productive. I'd like to communicate our enormous gratitude to the Argentinian and Insurance Superintendency and their entire team for their unwavering support, dedication, patience, and time in helping us have such a pleasant stay. It has been a very pleasant stay for all of us. I'd like to thank you for the warmth, way you received us. My congratulations. Everything was wonderful, the tango show included. Argentinian people know how to organize wonderful parties. We would like to thank our partners and colleagues at IAIS and the Microinsurance Network. Based on the partnership that has been created for such a long time and has been renewed in every consultative forum, we hope that this bond gets stronger in the future, helping support insurance supervisors in their demands in promoting insurance that is inclusive and accountable, reducing vulnerability. And of course, I'd like to also thank our panel members, moderators, and rapporteurs for their willingness to cooperate, to join us, and share their experiences and knowledge. The information that was discussed here is highly valuable for all of us. The fact that many of you have traveled long distances in order to be present here is a token of the relevance of digital inclusion. We are delighted to have the presence of 19 countries here representative. All in all, we are more than 70 attendees, including supervisors, industry representatives, the academia, and other stakeholders. As a matter of fact, we had 43 insurance representatives and supervisors and government representatives, the participation of whom was key for dialogue. This forum contributed major aspects on innovations, providing different focuses of the point of view of the industry and supervisors. The first session meant the opportunity to get to know InsurTech applications in the entire world, exploring the benefits that these applications are contributing to consumers, how technology can help us overcome the challenge of inclusive insurance and take care of the needs of emerging clients, giving supervisors a new essential outlook to adjust regulation and for the promotion of regulations in this new financial world. We are no longer talking about a remote future, but rather of the reality of the present time, has been stated by Carlos Belloni insurance, the way we know it today, is sure to change. The second session provided us the possibility to experience possibilities around this new reality with a comprehensive approach from the perspective of supervisors and of the industry on the hurdles that have to be surmounted, but also on the advantages and the risks to InsurTech applications. What they represent for consumers in various markets. We discussed innovations according to challenges for supervisors in connection to the knowledge of the client, claims processes, considering the use of the new technologies such as digital platforms, big data, AI, and whatnot, remote detection, telematics, blockchains, inter alia. We could see how this enabled greater democratization of insurance and financial inclusion. Nonetheless, in view of such a high level of information, we did identify a real risk of exclusion due to lack of access to devices such as a simple smartphone or excessive data on one client. From another perspective, session three presented examples on how Brazilian United States supervisors start dealing with these new challenges, providing a view on how the InsurTech activities can be regulated by means of coordination and cooperation among supervisors and the various stakeholders. This includes the creation of specific committees, task forces to study the topic at hand, and sandbox-type regulatory approaches. We highlighted the relevance of financial education programs so that innovation becomes effective. In the end, in the practical session number four, participants were able to explore the macro framework that need to be in place in order to support the implementation of new technological innovations in insurance initiatives. Discussions pivoted around the various approaches of supervision available for regulators who wish to promote InsurTechs, as well as the representatives of the industry and regulators, learning from one another through the exchange of their insights and experiences. We have heard several times during the afternoon today one thing that highlights from the rest, comments and reflections. As technology promotes inclusive insurance, it can as well bring about a risk of exclusion. But then how to protect clients' data and policyholder data in an environment where, in fact, data are already available? Based on the conceptual framework of InsurTech and its relevance for inclusive insurance markets, we have a great deal of solutions available, but at the same time, new and big challenges for stakeholders. As has been stated by our colleague Celia, I like that a lot, your phrase, the growth of technology in the environment of insurance, initially so, causes rejection and fear among supervisors. Nonetheless, it is necessary to face up to the challenge of adequate training provided to supervisors. At the end of the day, we can never go back in time. We cannot stay behind. Then how to get prepared for the exponential evolution of technology? We need to know how to deal with the lack of physical borders in the implementation of insurance techs, or even with the fact that insure techs may create the feeling for the client that they have a direct contact, but by and large, behind it, there's a long and complex value chain. How to apply the principles of proportionality, and along the learning process, discussion, coordination, and cooperation among the stakeholders is essential for an adequate regulation to be enabled, because you cannot regulate what you don't know, what you are not familiar with. The list of considerations is very long. There's a lot of information that we have to digest, but worry not. In a week time, in a few weeks, whatever we discuss today and in prior consultative forums from Asia and Africa, all this information will be available on the web pages of A2I and on the microinsurance network. in English and in Spanish. We hope that this 14th Consultative Forum has been accepted by you in helping you understand the goals, the roles, and challenges from the perspective of stakeholders, namely you, and how you can cooperate with one another in facing up to these challenges. We hope it's been a productive day, a very productive one, that may inspire you new ideas and initiatives, that learning and information on this can be multiplied and shared for responsible solutions to be adopted, and that all stakeholders in your own jurisdictions can go back to work together so that insurance markets become more inclusive. We sincerely wish that this is just the first event of a number of many others that will be very successful, because looking forward to the future, the initiative of access to insurance hopes to strengthen regional participation in Latin America, increase the focus on innovative topics, try new training formats, and establish new strategic partnerships. We hope we can meet you back again. Thank you so much. And to those of you who go back to your countries, I wish you safe travels. Thank you. See you next time.